All right, we'll go ahead and get started. Welcome to the last Cafe CSE of this academic year. It's been a great ride. This has become a great institution that we've had all kinds of stimulating discussions over the course of the year. This is something that we intend to continue going forward into the next year, and we're already working on exciting topics that we can hear about from experts here on campus. If you have an idea of something you'd like to hear here discussed here at Cafe CSE, be sure to come up and talk to either me, Chip Oskerson, the Acting Associate Director for the Center of the Study of Europe, or Martha Peacock, who's our Acting Director this year, or Laura Cook, who's our Managing Director for the Center, and we'd love to discuss those with you. This particular instantiation of Cafe CSE is happening in the middle of Celebrate Europe Week, and hopefully you've been able to take advantage of some of the activities that have already been going on, everything from Hollywood adaptations of European novels to European folk dance to lectures on medieval culture. If it's European, we got it. And there are activities that will be continuing throughout the rest of the week, and you have these listed on the flyer that you received when you came in. One particular event that I'll point out is the Eurovision Talent Contest, which will be happening tomorrow night. And I point that out because, as you see on the slide here, this is where we're going to be awarding the free airfare to a European study abroad. And if you'd like to be entered into this drawing, you need to text Europe plus your name to the number indicated here, and you can be entered for that drawing. So that drawing will be happening tomorrow night. And those other events, like I said, you can find there on the flyer. The discussion this afternoon is being recorded by BYU Radio and will be broadcast tomorrow at noon. And you can find it on byuradio.org or SiriusXM channel 143 if you're interested in hearing again or recommending it to someone who you think would be interested in it. Today there'll be a sign-up sheet that's going around. We use the sign-up sheet both to get feedback from you about Cafe CSE and about the events that we do, as well as for future advertisement. So we'd love to be able to keep in touch with you and let you know what's going on. Today our topic is why European women don't ... We're talking about stereotypes, and specifically stereotypes about European women. And stereotypes are tricky, right? Because they, on the one hand, there always seems to have some kind of kernel of truth to them. And yet the problem is always when you try to apply a general rule to every specific instance, it's always, always, always going to come up short. Okay? So the point of our conversation today is not to perpetuate stereotypes per se, but to interrogate them and to consider a little bit about how stereotypes maybe say more about the people that use them than the people that they're applied to. And today we have some real experts who will be able to share some interesting and exciting ideas given their expertise from the fields that they work in. Now, we have three presenters today as opposed to the normal two, which is exciting. And the idea behind this is that it will be more a discussion rather than a lecture to you. And you will have a chance to be part of this discussion. At roughly 20 to the hour, we will change formats and go to a question and answer. Because this is being recorded, we ask that you come up here to the mic here to my left and ask the questions from the microphone so that it can be picked up for recording purposes and so that the audience can hear you as well. And we'll go ahead and get to that. Now, at the end of immediately following the question and answer period today, we will announce the winner of this Cafe CSE's $50 gift card. That we're doing this as part of our 10-year anniversary. So again, if you text in your name, you'll be entered for that drawing as well. Immediately following, then, Cafe CSE will be having a reception out in the lobby where we'll be able to continue our discussion over the food that's been prepared for us, the tasty European delights that is so wonderfully prepared by our Brenda Christensen. And we thank her for that, as well as all the staff for the work that they do to make this come off. So let me introduce guests that we have today. First your left, we have Professor Valerie Hegstrom, who's Associate Professor of Spanish Literature and the coordinator of the Women's Studies Program here on campus. Professor Hegstrom's research involves the recovery of early modern Spanish and Portuguese women authors and their works. And she has published books and articles about early modern women playwrights and their theater, and is currently working on an edition of one of these authors to bring them to the public to a greater awareness of some of these works that have been long neglected. In the middle, we have Professor Martha Peacock, who's a professor of art history, and as I said, the director, acting director of the Center for the Study of Europe. Professor Peacock is in the art history department, and her research centers on the relationship of art to the lives of women in the Dutch Republic. And we were already favored this week to hear a little bit about her research in the opening of the Rembrandt exhibit at the Museum of Art, and encourage you to go over and see that if you haven't already had the opportunity. Then on the right, we have Professor Heather Jensen, who is Assistant Professor of Art History here at the university. Her research focuses on women in the art world of post-revolutionary France. She's the co-editor with a forthcoming volume on interior portraiture and masculine identity in France from 1789 to 1914. So we have experts here who that will give us kind of great insight into this topic, and we will turn the time over to them. Join with me in welcoming them.
I get to start our discussion today and give you a little bit of background about that, the title. Some of you maybe were wondering about that title. In 2004, a book was published by Marielle Giuliani that is titled Why French Women Don't Get Fat. And it was a runaway bestseller. It was immediately translated into 40 languages. It reached number one on the New York Times bestseller list and sold over 3 million copies. And in this, we are told that it will unlock the secrets of the French paradox, how women can eat all of these rich and indulgent foods and still stay slim. So that same year, Ellen de Bruin published a kind of follow-up book or a spin-off titled Why Dutch Women Don't Get Depressed. And as faculty who work on European women, we thought that these books presented an interesting platform from which to launch a discussion about European women and some of these stereotypes. As Professor Oskarsson mentioned, we hope to raise several questions today. How valid are national stereotypes? Can they be tied to factual data? Do European women see themselves as representing national stereotypes today? Is this how they judge themselves? Do national stereotypes benefit or hinder women? What are the differences between the stereotypes of Northern and Southern Europeans, and what has caused these differences? What were the religious, economic, political, and social developments that facilitated the formation of these stereotypes? We will not be able to address all of these, but these are some of the questions that are of interest. So we've selected a few key issues through which to consider this question. How are these women considered in relation to beauty and desirability and attractiveness? How are these stereotypes involved with issues of domesticity and maternity? Do these stereotypes suggest a kind of empowerment, and if so, in what arenas? And lastly, how do these stereotypes play into larger women's movements, maybe political, social movements in these various countries? So as you listen today, you will doubtlessly hear stereotypes that you may think are untenable, and you may say, I know fat French women, and I know depressed Dutch women, and I know cold Spaniards. And so we're not here to debate the validity of these so much as to ask, well, what is at stake with this, and to trace some of the historical development, and then ask how we might benefit by scrutinizing these. So I think I get first crack at this in looking at stereotypes around French women. So in addition to being thin, French women are beautiful, fashionable, stylish, glamorable, desirable, and enigmatic. And they are also vain and frivolous and self-indulgent and bad mothers. These are some of the stereotypes that we have seen. And they are perpetuated by various media. So I'm showing you two photographs. On there on the left is a photograph done by an American photographer of a woman who was wearing Christian Dior. It's done in the mid-1950s, and you can see she's there looking at a mirror, posing, primping, very elegant, very thin. And then on the right is a collage of film stills from the 2006 film by Sofia Coppola, also an American filmmaker, and her treatment of Marie Antoinette. And I don't know if you can see all the details, but it gets at the decadence that we associate with Marie Antoinette. There's lots of food, there's lots of partying, an excess of fashion, and so on. So both of these play, the images play to these stereotypes. Now, there are lots of antecedents prior to the 17th century, which is where I thought I would pick this up in terms of thinking about why these stereotypes have developed. And in the medieval period, there's the ideal of courtly love and that women are idolized and seen as superior. But I want to start with Louis XIV in Versailles, where court life set cultural expectations that are still with us today. The palace's grandiosity, its ornateness, and then individuals who were highly concerned with their appearance all created or proclaimed that the spectacle was a national pastime, right? The looking and being looked at was of central concern. And also this idea that artifice is superior to nature. And we see developing at the end of the 17th century certain luxury trades that facilitate this. Textiles, objets d'art, other items that were at its height, and there were industries that developed. And in fact, there's another book. I mean, there's just a huge industry for this stuff that's called The Essence of Style, How the French Invented High Fashion, Fine Food, Chic Cafes, Style, Sophistication, and Glamour. And at the very least, if they weren't invented by the French, they were highly cultivated by them. And these institutions have been of critical importance for the French economy. Marie Antoinette is a kind of a good case study because she's come to emblematize, I think especially for Americans, our view of French women, even though she was Austrian and her foreignness is of great concern sort of then and even now to the French. But she's shown as this ultimate party girl, right? Gluttonous spendthrift, who cared only about amusement and love trysts and rich food and fabulous clothing. And she was also the object of a slur campaign indicating that she was the most reprehensible of mothers. And so we can see these stereotypes at work with her. In the course of the 19th century, the business of beauty and fashionability and glamour just increased, and women were at the heart of this. This is what I see as the industrialization of femininity. And we have French novels, fashion magazines, paintings and prints that are spread throughout the world and that suggest that French women, and in particular, it's really La Parisienne, right, the woman of Paris, that they are the arbiters of taste, that they know what's going on. We have a few key figures, the consorts of the emperors Napoleon. So we have Josephine and then Empress Eugenie, who do create these standards of what should be worn and how one conducts oneself and so on. And this feeds the coffers of the French economy, just to mention two industries, the textile industry and the tourist industry were built upon women and some of these stereotypes. If you think about the advent of the department store, some of the other centers of entertainment and leisure, the opera houses, the theaters, the café concert, women are central to this. Beautiful, glamorous, stylish, chic, thin, right, women. And this has continued throughout the 20th century, and I won't rehearse all of this, but you can think about certain French film stars or Vogue, you know, Vogue Paris, and then there are all kinds of iterations of Vogue throughout the world. And many, many products that market the French woman and her life as ideal. So if we bring this back to Giuliano, who published that book, Why French Women Don't Get Fat, she has published 3 more books. There's a cookbook you can read that is, you know, the Why French Women Don't Get Fat cookbook. There's a book called Women Work and the Art of Savoir Faire, because you see, she's also the CEO of a wine company. So she's been able to sort of negotiate private and personal, or private and public, in interesting ways. And then French Women for All Seasons. And in the end, it's the same sort of advice about sort of moderation and appreciating perfection and beauty and cultivating confidence and other things that we'll talk about a little bit later.
Okay, I want you to look really closely at this slide, and when I flip to the Dutch archetype slide, you're going to hopefully get all the differences that the Dutch women wanted to point out with their book. This is it. Okay, all right, so Ellen de Brown in 2007 writes this book, Dutch Women Don't Get Depressed. And basically it was a parody on French Women Don't Get Fat. And it was this kind of a national challenge, basically, to, okay, you may be so obsessed with being thin and being beautiful, but we're a lot happier. And so it was, they actually did a happiness index at the Erasmus University in Rotterdam. And they essentially questioned women all over Europe. And as a matter of fact, it did turn out that Dutch women were happier than French women, that Dutch women were happier than Italian women, than Spanish women, even than British women, and especially more so than American women. And so she's a psychologist as well as a journalist. And so she did a lot of interviewing of women in the Netherlands as well as foreigners, and what their views of the stereotypical Dutch woman was like. In addition to that, she looked at a lot of history, interviewed a lot of historians. She herself was a psychologist, so talked to a lot of sociologists and so on. And interestingly, she comes up with the same sorts of stereotypes that predominated clear back in the 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th centuries. So a long history, she's suggesting, of stereotypes that have been so ingrained in the Dutch female psyche that it is that they just sort of naturally take over these same roles, these same stereotypes as all of their female predecessors. So she goes on now to talk about the stereotypes as they exist, and she says there's actually quite a similarity between what foreigners view Dutch women as being and how they view themselves. So she says, Dutch women are bossy. They love to tell their husbands what to do. Their husbands are, they don't like macho men. They like to be the boss. They like to tell their husbands what to do and so on. They are very good mothers as opposed to the French women, okay? Very, being a mother is very much a part of the female psyche from a very young age, thinking about becoming a mother, getting married. And in fact, it's an interesting statistic that only about 10% or even less of women work full-time in the Dutch Republic. About 75% of them work part-time. And most of them suggest they're really happy with this, that they don't want to work more hours, that they like having a balance between between family and work-related activities, that they, even if they were given more hours, they wouldn't take them, and they think American feminists got it all wrong, okay? The corporate world isn't that great. Why do we want to be a part of this? I'd much rather be at home with my children, enjoying life, gardening. Even women who don't have children frequently just work part-time rather than full-time. All right, so they think they've got a balance here in life that the rest of the world doesn't have. And if you would just learn from us, you would all have much happier lives here. Okay, so she basically says that this is based on the idea that women in the Netherlands for a long period of time have had access to personal choice and personal freedom. And she goes back historically, we'll talk more about this in just a moment, but clear back into the 13th century, 14th century, women could inherit property. And that continues throughout the Dutch history, which is not the case in most parts of the world, particularly at that point in time. They could inherit from their fathers. They had legal rights to represent themselves at law courts. We'll talk about their rights in business and so on. They got married much later because there wasn't this great necessity that they marry young so that they could have enough money to survive. The nuclear family first develops in the Netherlands, where you're not having to take care of old extended relatives, where you're their kind of servant, but you set up your own household. You're the boss. You take care of things. You control things. So there is this sense that for a long time, Dutch women then have had this ability to make choices for themselves, to choose their marriage partner. There were no arranged marriages. So this sense of I have control over my life. I'm empowered to be able to do what I want in my life. And as a matter of fact, that's the way most Dutch women still see their lives today, whereas some feminists in the Dutch Republic are really unhappy about the complacency. They say things like, happiness is overrated. You know, sacrifice makes you a better person. But it's not really catching on to the normal Dutch woman here that this might be a better life. So the two people I want to introduce to you, this on the left is Kanau Simons Hasselaar. And I brought her in. She was the heroine of the siege that the Spanish had around the city of Haarlem. And she was a 46-year-old woman, had children. She was an ordinary mother, housewife, okay? She essentially provides timber to build up the walls of the city. And yet she suddenly becomes this great heroine, supposedly leading 300 women into battle against the Spaniards. The Spaniards run fleeing, saying, the women have become men. And so then later images show her with halberd hair and gunpowder, swords, metal. I mean, she has become the mannish woman. And indeed, the inscription up here says, this is Kanau Simons Hasselaar. She was as brave as a man. So this crossing of gender boundaries really early on in the Dutch Republic, I think, led to women feeling an empowerment that gave them a kind of self-confidence that really has lasted. All right, so transgressing gender boundaries really early on, becoming bossy, becoming mannish, that precedent is set really early on. This woman over here is Anna Maria von Schirmann. She was the first woman, one of the very first women in Europe to ever go to the university. She went to the University of Utrecht. She had to sit behind a curtain, but nevertheless, she got to go to the university. She was the scholar of her age, really could outthink any of the males of her time. Descartes came and visited her. Royalty all around Europe wrote to her. This is a title plate in one of the most popular texts of the period, in which Jakob Katz tells us she could speak 12 languages, and I think like five of them were dead languages, Sanskrit, things like that. But she was an extremely intelligent woman who had a lot of confidence again in herself, became the celebrated figure of the Dutch Republic of her era. And so again, I think this sense of well-educated women, because the Dutch Republic is a society that provides education and a good social network for people and so on, sort of set that precedent for women in the Dutch Republic.
Okay, we started talking about this panel a year ago, and I have been to Spain and back since then, and there is no book in Spain that's called Why Spanish Women Don't. I mean, there's no recent book like that. I searched and searched. I went to many bookstores, talked to many people, searched online. But I do want to tell you about a book. I want to tell you about a book that was written in 1583, and it was called The Perfect Wife. Let's see if I can do this. Maybe. How do I do it?
There we go.
Okay, so The Perfect Wife was written by Fray Luis de Leon, who was an Augustinian friar, a poet, theologian, and academic, and he wrote it for his niece, who was a young woman who was getting married, and so it was a wedding gift to her. But The Perfect Wife is based on Proverbs 31, and so he sort of cites one of the verses from Proverbs 31 and then expounds on that in each chapter of the book. It became a wildly popular book. There were four editions before the end of the 16th century. Remember, it was first published in 1583, so toward the end. Four editions in the 16th century, at least two in the 17th century, four in the 18th century, at least six in the 19th century, 40 in the 20th century, and at least two already in the 21st century. It's like a popular book to give as a wedding gift to brides. Yay.
So these are some of the ideas that Fray Luis has about what the perfect wife is like. He says that she, and I have a few of the additions here, he says that the perfect wife is hardworking and thrifty, and she cares for her husband's property well. She keeps the house in order. She's the first one to get up in the morning and the last one to go to bed at night. She's adept at handwork, including things like weaving, embroidery, lace work, etc. And she is silent because women are the weakest of all animals on the planet, and so they're not really adept at things like business, and so they should keep quiet and just stay in their realm, which is the domestic realm. The perfect wife is also not just virtuous like Proverbs 31, but she's perfect, and so she should be the source of perpetual happiness for her husband. This image really kills me. I mean, it's like she looks like an automata or something, you know, like, anyway. She should be able to improve her husband's character flaws. I think this is not by being bossy, right? This is by silence, by long-suffering and patience, and she'll even be able to overcome his drunkenness. And she should be able to give her husband confidence in himself, his own abilities, her abilities to be a good steward over the house, and also her virtue. And she should have a clean body, and she should dress modestly, avoid things like jewelry and curling her hair, that would be bad. And she should also avoid dirty makeup. And makeup is dirty because it makes your body dirty, but it will also lead to lascivious thoughts, right? Dirty thoughts in the perfect wife, dirty thoughts in maybe her husband and in other men who might see her with her makeup, and other women who might see the makeup and think they want to wear makeup too. So there's a long discussion about how bad makeup is. So also the perfect wife, and there's not an image of this. This is a really fun image because it's an ad for the book in the 20th century. It's the perfect gift for a new bride, right? But the perfect wife is also the perfect mother. She rears good children, she teaches them proper values, and if they go astray, it's all her fault. In the 19th century, the perfect wife was also called the angel of the home. And there were lots of conduct manuals and novels written that sort of describe what this angel of the home is like in the 19th century. In the 20th century, the perfect wife and the angel of the home were still very popular under Franco, who was the dictator from 1939 through 1975 when he died. And there was also this idea that the perfect wife was the soul of the home. Under Franco, the Spanish women did not have the vote. They could not become university professors. They could not be judges. They could not testify in trials. They could not open a bank account without their husband's co-signing. They could not buy or sell goods. They could not inherit property. They could not go anywhere or stay overnight in a hotel without their husband's permission and his signing for it. They also would be jailed if they abandoned their home, even trying to escape from an abusive husband. So that's what the perfect wife stereotype looks like. I think so then, in that, given Fray Luis's ideas or Francisco Franco's ideas, I think the perfect wife we could ask the question, why Spanish women don't leave the house. And actually, I think the real question, though, is because all these ideas that I've described are prescriptive ideas rather than descriptive ideas. I think the real question about Spanish women is why Spanish women don't stay home, because the truth doesn't match the stereotype. The truth is that Spanish women don't stay home. They're outside the house, they're in the streets, they're working, they're very busy, and they're very seldom at home. And so that's the stereotype I'll put out there, and now discussion.
All right, so we thought we'd take first the issue of attractiveness or beauty, desirability, and I show you a painting on the left. This is by Manet, 19th century French painter, of a figure, Nana, who's the subject of a Zola novel, who is a high-class prostitute, and who is able to gain a lot of economic and even some social power because of her beauty and sex appeal. Then if we look at the cover of the Paris Vogue, this was in 1995. I thought it was interesting in talking about beauty, about what the prescriptions or the decrees of beauty were. Health, laughter, love, movement, not diet and cosmetics and clothing, right? This is interesting, and I think it gets to how French women define attractiveness and define the good life. And so both images attest that for French women, their corporeality or their embodiedness is an important part of their identity. But I think even more importantly, it's the confidence. And in fact, in another one of these books, because we're all trying to unlock the secrets of the of French women, what the author says, you know, what is the secret? It's that. It's confidence. They are confident in themselves, confident with their age, their body, and their power. And so, and even the greatest intellectuals do not dismiss the importance of this idea of attractiveness. But it's not just physical beauty. It's sort of working with what you have, but it's also cultivating a sense of self and of identity and of being a woman, not wife, just mother, but that centrality. And so those are some things to think about in terms of how women are defining attractiveness or desirability.
And so it's an interesting thing that, you know, you think about the feminist movement in the United States that probably a lot of you are familiar with. There's this sense of we don't want to cater to what men want us to be, right? So we don't wear makeup, we don't curl our hair, we don't dress in a seductive kind of fashion, that kind of thing. The Dutch, in some ways, then play into that in that there's this sense of we don't need this. So you're talking about self-confidence via looking beautiful, right? The Dutch see themselves as, hey, we're naturally beautiful and we do not need to use all of these things. And actually from the 16th century on, we have foreigners talking about how beautiful Dutch women are. It's healthy, fresh, red-cheeked, blonde, you know, beautiful women. And that has sort of persisted down through the years where they don't really feel the need to straighten their hair, put on makeup, go buy the latest fashions. And one of the things that Ellen DeBron puts out in her book is these women all have to wear bikes. Of course they're not going to be wearing high heels. Of course they're not going to be wearing tight clothing. They're going to be wearing something that's practical for the weather. You're biking along, right, in the wintertime. You need to have it be practical. You see this all the time of mothers carting their children in these luggage carriers, basically, in front of their bikes. I loved this image of the females in traditional Dutch costume in a parade riding their bikes and playing their musical instruments. But this is such a stereotype, the bike and the woman, such a stereotype in Dutch culture. This is de Kooning's painting, Woman with a Bike. You can see the Netherlandish flag on her chest here. But the sense of we are proud to be healthy and to be strong and to be fresh and to be vigorous, and we don't really need all of these things. But nevertheless, men could still turn it into a rather, you know, seductive kind of an image as well. So it's an interesting sort of sense of beauty there.
So I have to thank Heather because she pointed out to me that, sent me a quote from James Michener's book, Iberia. And in the 1960s, he was in rural Spain and came to a church and saw a sign posted with 12 sort of rules for women. And rule number 10 was, no decent woman or girl is ever seen on a bicycle.
Just so you know.
Let me talk, though, about Spanish women and sort of the way that Spanish women and Spanish beauty is exoticized. It's exoticized from outside of Spain, but also within Spain itself. And I think it's related to the idea of the perfect wife. I think it's related to enclosure, to women staying at home. And when they're in public, they should be covered. I think it's related to fashion, which has, and in this painting by Velázquez, you can see the woman with a manto, there are also mantillas. This one's not lace, it's a manto, which she could cover her head, but could also cover her face. And she has a fan, and I know you've seen images of Spanish women covering their faces with fans as well. And so on the one hand, that image is supposed to be enclosed and covered and not revealing, but on the other hand, the fact that it's enclosed and covered makes it forbidden and therefore also appealing. So you get all of these images of Spanish women, not just painted by Spanish men. This was what surprised me. I was looking for paintings of Spanish women with fans, and there are actually dozens of these paintings by American painters, French painters, British painters, Russian painters. I think this one's beautiful, A Spanish Girl by American painter. I don't know if it's Robert or Robert Henri. That's not his real name, but that's what he called himself. and then you get, this is Vogue's version of Penelope Cruz as Bizet's Carmen, right? And so this sort of exotic beauty. It's from within Spain, if you're from northern Spain or from the islands, from somewhere that's not Andalusia, you have the same sort of exoticizing of the Spanish woman, making her into the southern Spanish woman who has that Moorish background, who has that background that's related to flamenco and gypsies. And so I think that image is both related to the enclosure and also related to a kind of eroticizing of the Spanish female. There's the program cover from an opera, a light opera, about it's called The Beautiful Tapada, the beautiful covered woman, right? And so you cover the woman and make her more beautiful.
Okay, our next issue that we wanted to take up is the issue of domesticity and maternity, and this is something that's core to my research. So on the left is a British caricature of a French fashionable woman, or at least of the British adopting this idea of what it means to be a fashionable mama. And if you look very closely, you can see this woman is about to go out into society. You can see beyond in the window the carriage that's waiting for her there, the nursemaid holding her child up so that she can nurse, that fashion there. This is nursing, or what's it called? Maternity wear, yes, and that will facilitate this. But it is caricaturizing this desire to be sort of fashionable as well as to be a good mother, because this became a mandate. We have Rousseau in the 18th century who chastises all of the aristocratic women for sending their babies out to wet nurse and says, you should be natural, you should be breastfeeding, and instead of concerned with the availability of your body for your lover, your husband. And so, especially in the post-revolutionary period, there's a big push by the government then and now, just an awful lot of focus on children and the production of children, and all kinds of incentives that are given to women in terms of tax credits, in terms of maternity leave, postpartum physical therapy, to help women be more effective baby-making machines. And so there on the right is a somewhat contemporary photograph of a woman who is also part of this literature. This is Inés de la Farnese, and she has become an icon. She was a model and then a designer, and she's published all of these books, and she's also brought her children, and you know what it looks like to be a good mother. And so this question of having it all is something that is that French women, that all women, I think, have been dealing with for the last couple hundred years. And there are a lot of discussions now in France about how the adoption of American ideals of domesticity and maternity are actually depressing French women and making it impossible for them to be women first and then mothers. So this is something, this bad mother, good mother stereotype is something that's still very much in the press.
And of course, the Dutch are just the opposite of, as I've already said, have always had this good stereotype attached to them of being good mothers. And I find it interesting that your perfect wife cover is actually Vermeer's painting of a lace maker. So the French copy the good mother images from the Dutch. I mean, from the 17th century, we get the strong sense that motherhood defines the Dutch woman. She is this great mother. This is the most popular text of the 17th century. Outsells every other thing except for the Bible. It was Havelijk. It was written by Jacob Katz, who was a kind of moralist of the day. But it is a book that basically outlines the six stages of a woman's life, from maid to sweetheart to bride to wife to mother to widow. and these are depictions around her. Throughout the text, it talks about how to be a good woman at each stage of your life. Okay, so a lot of historians have wanted to look at this and say, look at how patriarchal the Dutch culture is. They're telling women what they must do at every stage of their life. But I'm saying, shouldn't we be asking ourselves the question, how could it possibly be that a book all about women for women readers was the most popular text of the period? That says something to us, I think, about the power of women and the fact that, you know, that so much attention was paid to them. It's an interesting thing to me. Heather and I both work a lot on motherhood in imagery. And anthropologists some time ago, during the feminist movement, have begun to discover that actually the most equitable cultures, gender-wise, were cultures that paid a lot of attention to women's roles, traditional women's roles, motherhood, you know, the household, domesticity, all of those kinds of things. And I think that this shows us that this is a high status role. Being a mother was not, you know, the low status position that sort of feminists give it today in the United States. It was a high status role, given a lot of public attention, and therefore it generated just tons of visual images, okay? Just many, many prints, paintings of women taking care of children in the household, performing domestic tasks in the household, but also this contributed to the household economy. It was like what the husband brought in terms of money for the household. So that so much attention being paid to them, not just in the private sphere, but in the public sphere, all these paintings, all these books, all these prints going out, I think is constantly thrusting out to people, mothers are important. They're bringing up good little burgers and burgeresses for this new middle class society that we've developed here, right? So they play this important role. Beverwijk, a doctor of the 17th century, writes this book, Damenheit von der Frauen geschlacht, which is basically on the excellence of the female sex. He argues that women are better than men. And he says, women are like rulers. They're like kings. They're like princes. They have their own little republic in their household. And it's so important to our society that they be raising up then this next generation. So a lot of emphasis placed on the importance of motherhood. From the late 16th century, clear up to the 17th century, we have these images of totally bossy women. So here, for example, is this great character of a woman who's taking her husband's trousers. Who wears the pants in the family, right? He's taken his off. He's putting them on his wife here. As she holds up her hand over his head, beating him into submission. This guy over here is giving the kiss of the thumb. It was this sign that I've submitted to my wife. Back here in the background, they're forcing their husbands to spin. She carries the Overhand banner, okay? Overhand. We have the upper hand here, right? It's just like the English expression. And guess what? There is a feminist journal published still today in the Netherlands that is called The Upper Hand. So.
Running out of time, but this is just a picture of a Spanish interior from the early modern period, and then also the famous painting by Murillo of the two women looking out from a window. And so you have the idea of women's enclosure again, and it's built into the interior spaces, that the room represents a woman's room in the house with a raised stage and pillows for the women to sit on, almost like a harem, right? And that usually there would be like screens on the windows so that if a woman looked out, she couldn't be seen, but that's obviously not the case in the Murillo painting. And so there's this constant transgression of the norm, right? And so the idea of interior spaces versus the idea of exterior spaces. And I'm just going to stop there so that we can move.
Agreed.
Should we just?
Why don't you just sum up with one feminist statement about what we're going to end with?
I think I want to go to this image, with both of these more contemporary, so you can see with the Vogue Paris, there's actually a concern that what we, at least on the part of the French, that they're becoming too Americanized in terms of ideal femininity and poisoned by this new Rousseauian idea about natural motherhood. And that's the idea of Elisabeth Badinter, who's one of the leading philosophers in France, who makes the argument that that motherhood is turned into a conflict, who insists that women should be women first and mothers second. and that basically the green movement and the back to nature attachment parenting, you know, using organic diapers, all of this has been a way of tying women to the home, which has caused all kinds of discussions in France, in England, and in the United States.
And I've basically said the feminists are unhappy with Dutch women. They're too content to play all of these roles. So I'll just end up with Opzij, which is the About She or Make Way feminist journal in the Netherlands. Just doesn't seem to be catching on. But what a lot of feminists are saying, or what a lot of women are saying now, is maybe there's a fourth wave of feminism, and maybe the Dutch women have actually found it, a balance that's saying we don't want to be just like men. In fact, more men are asking for part-time work to be at home with families as well. So maybe the fourth wave of feminism is saying, yes, you have the right to choose, but not what you choose and what you can do are not always going to be the same thing.
So I just wanted to say with the last three slides really quickly is that women have Women have always had power in Spain and have always been outside in Spain. Saint Teresa of Avila obviously had has had a lot of power in the Catholic Church, and this is a painting of her that was done during her lifetime. But of course, Bernini could eroticize her and turn her into this other sort of exotic Spanish woman. And then this is Catalina de Arauzo, and I threw her in because I wanted a Spanish woman who would be equivalent to Martha's women, Dutch women, because there were women soldiers in the early modern period. There were women soldiers during the War of Independence against France in the early 19th century, and there were women soldiers in the Civil War on the Republican side against Franco. Also, there are women politicians. There are lots of women in politics in Spain right now. And this particular woman was the president of Madrid for more than a decade and also the head of the Senate for a couple of years. There are 40% of the Congress of Deputies are women, and 36% of the Senate in Spain, the upper house of government, are women. But when I Googled in Spanish, La Mujer Política Española, the second hit on my Google search came up with this website that said, who is the most beautiful Spanish politician and who can vote? And so currently, Arantxa Quiroga has received 1,179 votes, but you can go online and choose your favorite most beautiful Spanish politician.
All right. Okay, now we'd like to open this up to question and answer. If you have a question, I invite you to come down here to the microphone and to ask your question. I'll kind of get it started as people come down. How important is nationality in defining these stereotypes, or why is nationality seemingly so important? Is maybe a question to ask. How important is Dutchness, for example, to an image of a woman, or Frenchness, and why is the national label so important in this case?
I think to a certain extent it goes back to our fall conference on Europe in a nutshell. You have these competing aspects to Europe right now, where you have Europe, right, that everybody's supposed to belong to and buy into and feel like a European citizen, right? But on the other hand, I mean, this Dutch book was really written as an attack sort of on, hey, but we're proud to be Dutch women, not French women, kind of a reaction to it. So I think there are those competing tensions of, yeah, we're all supposed to Europe, and we're all supposed to get along, especially in times of economic crisis. Don't
right.
you think there's
yeah.
more of a sense of, hey, we're Dutch and we're different from poor struggling Spain down right. there who yeah. don't really want to help, right? So there is this, there are those competing loyalties.
I think the peninsula is the European other and always has been. I mean, when we do, you can look at books on European women, and there will be almost no information about Spanish women, for example, in the early modern period, in the modern period. I think that the Pyrenees and the Moorish invasion from the Middle Ages is still affecting that. When we talk about Europe, we think England, but we think France, we think Germany, we think Italy, and maybe the Netherlands, right? But we don't think Spain.
Is that Franco? Is it more Franco than anything else, or is Portugal in a similar situation?
Well, Portugal was under Salazar all those years that Spain was under Franco. But I think that it's still the black legend. I honestly think it's still the black legend. Yeah. I think the early modern period is still affecting the way Europeans see each other.
Yeah. Excellent.
I'm wondering about the stereotype why European women don't shave. I know it's a stereotype, but I also served my mission in Hungary, and I saw both sides to that. So.
Oh, I don't know. I feel like that's an old stereotype that I think is perpetuated as a sort of anti-Europeanism on the part of Americans, right? So I just don't think that is, I think a lot of these European women have adopted American standards of hygiene or cosmetics, I don't know what you want to call it.
Sitting right now are the dropping birth rates in Europe as women turn to educational fields and careers that take them out of the home. And I know that traditionally, the ama de la casa stays with the children. But throughout Europe, why are European women not having children?
Well, it is the case that the fertility rate in Spain is one of the lowest in Europe, and so there's sort of the stereotype that Spanish women stay home and have children, but it's not the case. In fact, Spanish women also have the oldest average age now of giving birth, and so they're up to 31 point something, right? When that's how old they are when they finally decide to have their first child, which is probably their only child, right? And so I think that Spanish culture has, after 1975, has changed drastically in the last 30 years. I mean, the progress towards sort of women's rights and women's opportunities to work and to be educated have just dramatically shifted. It's been a dramatic shift in Spanish culture.
And I would answer in France, the last statistics I saw were 2010, that France has one of the highest birth rates in Europe. Their average is 2 children instead of the 1.7 that I think was the average. There are all kinds of incentives for that. And 82% of women of childbearing age work outside the home, in addition to having more children. And again, this is called the école maternelle, which from age 3 on, you are guaranteed to have basically childcare from 8:30 in the morning until 4:30, and then you can pay a little bit more until 6:30. That makes it very easy for men and women to work outside the home, but you notice the name of the school, it's the mother school, right? So it's still the idea that it's the mother's responsibility to figure out where that child goes. So there's some deeply ingrained patriarchal elements to that.
Thank you.
So thank you very much. I thought the contributions were really interesting and rich. I like the images a lot, but can I maybe just add a couple of points to maybe expand the discussion? If you think about the Middle Ages, for example, that's my area. You know, of course, that any woman who dared to dress in men's clothing, think of Joan of Arc, was then regarded as a heretic and normally burned at the stake. So there was a very strong attempt by the church, by the male patriarchy, of course, to secure the gender roles. That's, of course, that's the Middle Ages, but if we turn to the modern age, what I noticed was in your presentations, very interesting, but this is all intentional media presentations. So I really missed a little bit the whole gender issue. It's not just women, how women are presented, but it's always both sides.
Absolutely.
I think for us to understand these issues, we have to really to look both at both sides of the gender divide. And secondly, I think we need to understand a little bit more, and maybe you as art historians can help us better, the intentionality of these images. I think that applies very much to what we have even today, and you showed some modern images, it's intentionality. There's a certain intention to create some kind of stereotypes or roles. And my last point might be, if you could also consider a little bit more the whole component of discourse. This is always a matter of national discourses. So I think that shapes certain, let's say, American female concept, German, Hungarian, whatsoever. By the way, with the Hungarian women, I wonder how this gentleman knows that these women do not shave. But anyway, that's none of my business. Thank you very much.
Well, I think you're absolutely right about cross-dressing, and we have a lot of early modern farces and things to deal with this. Talking about discourse, it's a really interesting discourse in the Dutch Republic, because not only was Kano Simons Hasselaar this great warrior woman, but almost every city in the Netherlands during the revolt had their own heroine. Okay, so coming out of that is this really interesting discourse. I think that those bossy women scenes are in part a reaction to, hey, these women have gone overboard here, they've become too mannish. And you have these a discourse at the beginning of the 17th century of this guy who says, yeah, we can appreciate Kano Simons Hasselaar, she was this great warrior and all that, but I would hate to be married to such a woman. Or at the end of the century, there's two men in a discourse, actually, in a text. One talking about, look at how great women warriors are, and look at Queen Elizabeth, and how what a wonderful queen she was for England. And then the other guy saying, you know, this is against God's law, so the very kinds of things you're suggesting, this is not natural for a woman to dress like a man, be a man, all of those kinds of things. So I think it's constantly in the public discourse, even from a very early age, of how far should a woman go, right? How far can I go in terms of freedom and rights and all of those kinds of things, which is the same for the feminist movement of the 20th century, right? You've gone overboard, this is too far, this is scaring the men, or even a lot of women, right, who have a problem with this. And so I think the discourse you're talking about now is related to some of the things we were talking about of, okay, but you know, if you celebrate mothers too much, well then you've really thwarted our feminist movement, and you really should be, I mean, feminists attacking other women for saying, you should go out and work. You're not teaching your daughters good lessons about, you know, women empowerment and things if you stay at home and you just take care of your children. So I think it's constant discourse and comparing themselves to the Americans, to the British, to French, to Dutch.
Right. And I would say with the gender, sorry, where did you go? You're in the back. I completely agree. And if we had more time and sort of a different format, we would think about those things. As I was working through these stereotypes, I thought, I think a lot of these same things are stereotypes for French men as well, in terms of careful grooming, you know, better lovers, et cetera, et cetera. And so that goes to, there are then national stereotypes that are both for men and women.
In the early modern period in Spain, cross-dressing women were wildly popular. Catalina de Arauzo was wildly popular. There was a biography written about her. There were plays written about her. She saw the Pope, had an audience with the Pope, and he gave her permission to continue dressing as a man. She was just wildly popular. Queen Christina from Sweden was wildly popular in Spain. They loved her because she cross-dressed. There were cross-dressing women all over the stage. They just loved the idea, and the actresses and in Spain we had actresses as well as actors, because they just had different feelings than they did in England at the time about what would be immoral. So there were lots of women cross-dressing as men on the Spanish stage, and the actresses would often wear their costumes off stage, out in the public, even though they weren't supposed to, until they would get some kind of fine, and then they would lay off for a while, and then they would dress as men again. And that became eroticized as well, because they were wearing breeches, and so you could see their legs, and so, you know, I mean, you could read it both directions, right? Sure. And then there were a few cross-dressing males on stage, only a few, and that was really, really scandalous when a cross-dressing male showed up. And I only know of two examples of noblemen in characters who were noblemen in plays who cross-dressed as women. But
and I, because I work on cross-dressing as well, will just say that even though sort of officially women were, prescriptively were not to cross-dress, this is where you have the fashion of women wearing pants come of age in the late 19th and early 20th century, is a kind of industry, right, where pants are being produced and women are wearing them to wear bicycles and so on. And they just 3 months ago, some of you may have seen this in the news, revoked the law or the decree in Paris that women could not wear pants. That had been on the books for 200 years. No one had bothered to take it off because, of course, people had been transgressing it for a long time. But when it was passed in 1799, you had to go to the minister, to the prefect of the police, and say, here's my doctor's note for why I need to cross
cross dress, except for masquerades, but then think about the modern period, George Sand and others, you know, the best known kind of cross dressing women, they're French and actresses and so on. So we have prescriptive and descriptive, and we've all, I think, touched on that too. What's the reality and what's the ideal? You know, those are different.
Okay, we have time for just one last question.
Hi. I really love stereotypes. For some reason, I'm semi-infatuated with them and where they come from and why we have them. And something that I've noticed about stereotypes is how they vary so much everywhere you go. I mean, in Western Europe is different than Eastern Europe and different than the States, and they vary so much. But one thing that I've kind of noticed everywhere that has stereotypes is they have two things, they have media and politics. And I wonder how much do you think that stereotypes of European women, I guess, for example, come from the politics and media and it goes and the people accept it, or vice versa, or where do you think those come from?
Obviously a combination, right?
Right.
I would say a combination. You know, we had a lot of, you're missing some of the best of our discussion because we could only get to certain things, but we kept saying, I mean, when we were talking about Dutch mothers, Valerie asked me, yeah, but do they do that because it's prescribed to them that you're happy doing this, or are they really happy? So, I mean, right, we're all part of a context and we can't be divorced from that. And so, yeah, we're probably buying into a lot of ideas that are already out there. But I do think there are some interesting sort of psychological and sociological studies that are done that can suggest that, you know, autonomy is obviously a question about how much is individual choice and how much we're really sort of forced into situations by our societies. But when there are models, I think this is why this is an interesting topic, at least for me, is when there's a model of a woman doing something that is ennobling or gives her a certain status or makes her important or is something you admire, right? Then that gives you that choice to say, I'm going to follow that stereotype because it's something I choose. I want to be like that. It's something I admire. So I think there is this degree of autonomy in choosing to follow a stereotype, right?
One of the interesting things about this book, can I just interject this, is I was reading a review in the New York Times, and the reviewer said, you know, I find myself at the same time wanting to throw this book across the room and memorize its every, you know, page, right? Because there's this, like, an attraction and repulsion to the stereotype of I shouldn't buy into it, and yet I want to, right? That I think it keeps us going back to those things.
Thank you. Well, join with me in thanking our presenters here for a wonderful discussion.